Everyone has one. Some call it a hobby, others call it an interest, and yet others still call it a career, if they're lucky. But in every case, it's a passion. What is a passion? The dictionary has some interesting ideas on the concept, saying that calling it a powerful or compelling feeling, an outburst of intense emotion, a strong affection or enthusiasm for an object or concept. When in action, a passion is what widens the features of the face that holds it or narrows them in intense focus. A passion is a craving to experience, which begets understanding and yet more craving. And as a logophilic lover of language, passion is what I felt when I first encountered Angela Carter's The Smile of Winter. Carter's short story seduced me with the fine features of its scintillatingly sensory sentences, calling me in for a closer look at its syntax and the curious with curious caresses, probed past commas into the secrets of a concrete landscape. The sheer amount of detail in the piece, even when freed from its cultural influence and authorial presence, made it ideal for a formalist critique, because a formalist criticism is essentially the removal of all but the critic and the work. It is the most intimate form of literary analysis, and one I couldn't resist indulging in with The Smile of Winter. But who could when confronted with a story that endeavors to reach the limitations of metaphor and uses literal imagery as a transparent mask for emotional subtleties? The story stands as a titan, a testament to Angela Carter's mastery of the arts of fiction and figurative language. Today, I'm going to retrace my overindulgent journey into Carter's world and map out the landscape of the beauty of sorrow. Beginning with the blue of sky and ending with the blue of sea, The Smile of Winter is a sunrise, enlightening a simple scenic tour and transforming its twists into an evocative defense of the narrator's self-accepted depression. From the water's wind-whitened edge to the women working around it, and the sighs of salt in the trees, the nameless narrator's sadness is seeped into the pores of a village more person than place, leaving it deeply immersed in the personification of the narrator herself. To explore this concept, first we'll discuss the resilient landscape of the narrator's adopted home, then look at her connection to those who people the place. And finally, we'll examine Carter's use of color as contrast. In order to understand the narrator's appreciation of her depression, we must first understand the resilient landscape that embodies it. The resilient but stoic static nature of the narrator's chosen home simultaneously shows us her unwillingness to relinquish her depression and the prevalence of its merits. The short story takes place in a seemingly remote fishing village, which suits the narrator's need for isolation. She came there with the express purpose of being alone, a purpose shared by the old houses in the village, which are also dedicated to seclusion. Between the gardens and the abandoned fishing boats, everything is so harmoniously in tune with the time of year that it looks forsaken. Sometimes the whole village looks forsaken. From the trees, subtly wrapped by the weather, squat on their hunkers, to the houses and ageless ocean, there is a sense of unyielding consistency. The trees are one of the most important elements in the story because of their repeated mention. They are hands down the most mentioned element of the landscape. These silent and persistently present plants embody the narrator's resolve to simply remain there, undisturbed and undaunted. Even as she describes the uncompromising devotion of their growing in such a brutal climate, she's doing the same. Her depression is thriving in a stark winter paradise where beauty and barren blend. The other element of the frigid landscape that is exceedingly important is the winter moon. Both the narrator and moon are ever present, but likewise alone, fated only to watch a world removed from them. And much like a moon which lacks a light of its own, but reflects the sun's, the narrator mirrors the beauty around her, casting it back, but failing to retain its essence. This secondhand light is the light of perspective. And as the moon brightens the night, so does the narrator brighten the cold world. Yet what she reflects upon is indifferent to her. And it's the honesty of this indifference that she's drawn to. She's fixated on it, for she yearns to emulate it and gain the solace of an unattached existence, of apathy. Because frankly, she cares too much. Both the rustic landscape and narrator are nameless. But this lack of designation doesn't damage their reality, so much as it highlights their kindred connection. Bound in ambiguity, both place and person exist with a stoic resolution to achieve perpetual continuance, which is absent the need to acknowledge, to be acknowledged or named by the outside world. She wants nothing more to persist as the squat pines and remain as the old houses, in spite of the harshness of salt-stiffened breezes and the rise of eroding tides. Having looked at the landscape's rugged resilience, we'll now turn to those who people it and discover the purpose of the narrator's neighbors. The resilience the narrator imitates did not come without a price. The shield of isolation she's erected has blocked out the potential for intimate connections, while simultaneously piquing her interest in them. Throughout the story, she watches those around her in silence, her proximity belying her connection to them. Everyone is just a breathing image to her and she to them. And it's always them or they. She's the only one who walks alone in her story. She watches the motorcyclists race by the beach at night beneath her window, but never attempts to join them. The same is true when the old women look at her with curiosity and contempt. She never tries to talk or take part in their lives or even find out what it is about her they don't like. There is a fearfulness and awe in her separation from the local packs. The bikers are graceful specters at night, and the women are intimidating guardians of the day. By viewing them from a distance, she's able to more fully comprehend what they are, who they are. Yet likewise, she can only see beauty and worth because she is removed from them and absent self-worth. Now that we've looked at the narrator's reflection in the stoic and stationary landscape and examined the people who roam it, let's splash a little contextual color on the smile of winter. Like the editor of a black and white movie, selectively retouching its everyday items in technicolor, the narrator capably highlights objects with emotional subtext to provide both complement and contrast to the depression that drives the smile of winter. Every time the narrator flicks her brush across the page, little pieces of consolation and happiness emerge, clothed in the vibrant colors absent in the rest of the earth tone story. The red pegs staking out the sandy trails of the wistfully admired writers highlight her passion for them, while the rare pink shells blush with innocence and fragility in a world poised to crush them. Accented by the audible imagery of the otherwise grave village woman laughing is their electrifying gold teeth. All about the earthiness of sandy shores and the gray grit houses sails the violet light of dawn on the chameleon colors of the sea. Again, the ever-perceptive narrator is dutifully aware in catching these concrete details. Upon seeing an orange hung in a tree with gold balls like a magic trick, she notes that it does nothing but stress by contrast the prevailing static sobriety of everything else. But she craves this contrast, for it both gives her the stability of the unchanging and puts a spotlight on the limited but blinding beauty that surrounds her everyday life. To bring things full circle, we once more see the pine trees that she seeks to emulate, sitting in a subdued but noticeable green beneath their winter wrappings. Part landscape, part comrades, and ultimately part of the coloring book, this loyal pack of green bears that attends the narrator while she sits otherwise alone in her garden portray the most important shade of all. She seeks to grow as the greenery does, spending more time with the pack of trees guarding her garden than any of the packs predatorily patrolling the beachscape below it. Perhaps it is because she can emulate them more easily than the others, because of their stillness, and because their type of life doesn't involve moving on. Having broken the boundaries between black and white words and the colors they carry, we come at last to the end of the smile of winter and the beauty of its sorrow. I mapped out the lay of the landscape and marked the narrator's reflection in its snow. I introduced her neighbors and noted how far from her they live. I showed the rainbow that ran through her stormy skies to contrast and complement them in turn. By using the land, people, and colors, the narrator of The Smile of Winter is able to turn her home into a pulsing personification of herself, which actively defends her depression with the beauty blossoming around it. There's a powerful awareness in loneliness of the world, of those who walk it, and yes, of the self. In choosing to describe her world as she did, the narrator made her defense of her depression all the stronger by highlighting that awareness, an awareness she would not have been capable of had she lost herself to depression. In the end, it's a familiar concept. Life is black, just like my soul. Life is pain, Highness. Darkness devours light. The silver lining is but a sharp edge on a dark and ominous cloud, honed by malice and hovering over an equally black world. We've all heard the stereotypical goth stance, morose and hopeless, dismissive of everything. However, rather than releasing into the world another nihilistic naysayer who bemoans the pointlessness of it all, Angela Carter instead chose to gift us with a narrator whose sadness is illuminated by the winter's moon and lapped up into eternal waves. With a paramount passion, she gave us a woman whose pain personifies the simple elegance of winter in a seaside village and exposed to all the beauty of sorrow. So next time you're depressed, why not take a look around your world and see what technicolor passions are still pulsing when everything else has turned to gray?